A lonely impulse of delight drove to this tumult in the clouds. I balanced all, brought all to mind. The years to come seemed a waste of breath. A waste of breath, the years behind. In balance with this life, this death. Hello, my name is Peter McGarry. I am an aviation and history enthusiast, and I live in the Midwest region in Ireland. Between the years 1946 to 1961, over 250 lives were lost in various air crashes at Shannon Airport. This film serves as a memorial. Starting with the airport's first fatal crash in 1946, and ending with the last in September 1961, I have produced a short documentary to remember these lost passengers and flight crews. At its heart, Shannon is an international airport that has had to battle for its existence in good times and bad. So tonight, we take a trip through the mist of time and recall these tragic events which have in their own way led to the relative safety of modern aviation, which we all take for granted today. For anybody living in this region who has memories of these events, I invite you to submit your comments and more. To everybody who has so far provided sources of information used in this production, I thank you. Prior to moving on to a history of the crashes, it's best to outline a brief history of the airport itself. In the early 1930s, Shannon started out as three grass runways. In 1935, the Irish government took a decision to initiate a survey to find a suitable base for the operation of seaplanes and land planes on a transatlantic basis. Construction started in the years 1935 to 36. With extensive drainage of this marshy site. The thinking at the time was that seaplanes would dominate overseas flights and that land planes would be used to connect Shannon to points across Europe. As people may already know, Foyn's seaplane base is located on the opposite bank of the estuary, a short distance from the Shannon base. In the early phases of survey work, the celebrated American aviator Charles Lindbergh was brought in to advise on planning. While presented as an American icon, clouds would in time gather over his reputation. In particular, his involvement with the Nazi hierarchy in his interests in eugenics or purity of breed. But that is a story for another day. American Overseas Airlines operated the first scheduled flight, and Shannon was on its way as a transit point for the famous and not so famous of the day. The main runway at Shannon in those days was 0623, a rough east-west by compass points. Strangely enough, modern maps show the alignment as 0724. Numerous cross runways intersected the main one, the most significant being 1432, or a rough north-south alignment. We start on December the 28th, 1946. TWA Lockheed Constellation, tail number November Charlie 86505, named the Star of Cairo, is operating a flight between Paris, Orly and Shannon. Final destination is New York via Gander, with 23 crew and passengers on board. The captain on the flight is Hubert Tansey, assisted by pilot Cliff Sparrow. While at Orly Airport, maintenance was carried out on the plane's altimeter. The altimeter has two static line inputs, one on the wing and the other in the forward landing gear bay. This maintenance issue will have a major bearing on events a few hours later. At 2:06, the flight reported over the range station at 1,200 feet. Cloud base that night was 400 feet. Visibility 1 mile. Wind 120 degrees. And speed at 5 knots. The constellation turns left for finals to approach runway number 14. During this turn, the aircraft lost 150 feet and the left wing hit the ground on Inish Macnaughton Island, which is located in the mouth of the Fergus estuary. 25-year-old flight attendant Vina Ferguson described a slight bump as the aircraft hit the ground at over 125 miles an hour. The aircraft swung left with port wing breaking up. The cockpit crew were thrown free and a fireball ensued. Tanzi was knocked unconscious, but as he came to, still strapped to his seat, he realized the extent of his injuries to his leg, which would later be amputated in Ennis Hospital. Ferguson quickly unbuckled herself and was soon giving aid to the survivors. First crash crews arrived some 2 hours later to a scene of devastation and infernos. Their efforts were hampered by having to wade through deep mud. Later on, small boats were used as the estuary tide rose higher. Ferguson was quick to respond to the screams of a baby, Charles Waterbury, who suffered mild burns and a fractured thigh. The baby and his mother, war bride Edith Delaby, were soon reunited and transferred to St. John's Hospital in Limerick. In the days following the accident, a high-powered Lockheed team from Burbank, California, soon identified the incorrect line input into the altimeter as the cause of the crash. Vina Ferguson went on to marry a TWA captain, Ron Heckman. Cliff Sparrow, the pilot, married his physiotherapist. Tanzi received a record-breaking legal settlement and was assigned a TWA desk job. Unhappy with the change in his TWA career, Tanzi became a flight instructor at a California flight school. While on a lesson with a novice student, Tanzi suffered a heart attack and the novice student crashed the training aircraft, killing both. Some 18 months later, Shannon was yet to experience an even greater loss of life with the Pan American crash. Pan Am flight 110 was transiting from London to Shannon as one leg of an around-the-world flight which had originated in San Francisco. 31 passengers and crew are on board the Empress of the Skies, a newly built Lockheed L049 Constellation. Before the end of the night, just one of these people would make it out alive. At 1:59, it reported to Shannon Tower that it was at the Limerick Junction marker. The flight received clearance for a landing on runway 23, but missed the approach and elected to go around again. It was on the second approach that it struck a stone fence, 2,379 feet short of the main runway. The initial crash ripped the aircraft and its engines apart. The fuselage was ripped into three separate sections and a fireball ensued. According to the surviving passenger, the engines seemed to be operating normally also during the second approach. The fastened seatbelt, no smoking sign was on. He heard the flaps extend and observed that the flight altitude was normal. He stated that the first contact with the ground felt as though the airplane had made a hard landing on the runway. Immediately following, however, severe jolts were felt and flames swept through the cabin from the forward part of the fuselage. He then realized that the aircraft had crashed. He had been thrown forward in his seat, but was saved from injury by his safety belt. When the aircraft stopped, he noticed that though filled with flames, the cabin remained substantially undamaged and that all the passengers were in their seats, but made no sound or movement. He said he did not believe himself physically or mentally capable of opening any of the emergency exits, so he crawled through the rear of the cabin and dropped through a large tear in the fuselage to the ground. The aircraft first struck a stone fence which collapsed the nose and left main landing gear toward the right main landing gear from its mounting. All four engines were also torn from the aircraft during the course of the crash and came to rest slightly forward of the main wreck, which was 1,780 feet northeast of the main runway 23. The fuselage, broken into three sections, was scattered around the fuselage and the wings. Marks on the ground made by the propellers indicated that at impact all had been rotating with normal glide power. The governor for number one propeller was bench checked and found to be set at 2300 revs per minute. The distance between the individual blades marks for propellers 1, 2 and 3 were all about 30 inches apart. Forward speed of the aircraft was calculated to be approximately 108 miles per hour, since considerable deceleration probably occurred before the propeller blades marked the ground. The speed of the aircraft on final approach before the first impact was substantially greater. All evidence found and the statement of the surviving passenger indicated that all engines were operating normally during the approach. An examination of the cockpit controls and instruments was impossible because of the complete fire destruction. However, no indication was found that other than normal operation was expected before the crash. The lone survivor was a Lockheed employee by the name of Mark Worst. Mark was Lockheed's former maintenance manager at Shannon and survived by literally falling through a break in the fuselage. Unknown to Mark was that his wife was at the airport and joined rescue crews as they hurried to the scene. On learning that there was just one survivor from the 31 passengers and crew, she was literally dumbstruck when she realized that this indeed was her husband. American dead included 10 crew and 9 passengers. Other passengers were 5 Italians, 2 Indians, and an 18-year-old British girl. During a night landing in Brussels, the lighting on the left side of the cockpit went out because of a faulty rheostat or dimmer switch. An entry described the fault was duly placed in the aircraft's flight log. After landing, the problem seemed to resolve itself, but failed again on its approach to London. To overcome the problem with the London landing, the crew used the cockpit chart light. On the ground in London, the defect was detected, but they did not carry spare cockpit illumination bulbs. Of interest, during the researching this crash, I came across two references to a fire that night in which occurred in Shannon's ILS or instrument landing system. Strangely enough, Lockheed themselves make reference to the ILS system in perfect operation on the night. Following the crash, a mass grave was prepared at Drumcliff Cemetery just outside Ennis. Over the years, the grave has been maintained by the airport police and fire service. The exact site of the crash is indicated by the satellite photo of runway 23 as shown right here. Prior to its closing off, this section of road was a haunt of aircraft enthusiasts, as it puts you directly beneath the aircraft as they made their final approaches.
In the muddy Shannon estuary, the KLM Super Constellation airliner Triton lies where it crashed 2 minutes after takeoff from Shannon Airport. Two Americans, Mrs. Farrington and Mr. Reinfeldt, were among the 28 survivors. 28 others died. The death roll might well have been heavier had not Miss Elizabeth Snyder stopped a passenger from lighting a cigarette in the cabin, which had quickly filled with petrol fumes. Dr. Charles Farrington and his son also escaped. 26 of the victims are known to have died from inhaling petrol fumes. This was stated at the inquest, at which Dr. O'Connor, on the left, is the coroner. Severe criticism has been made of the delay of about 3 hours before rescuers reached the stricken aircraft.
Events move on to the 5th of September 1954. Lockheed Super Constellation PHLKY Triton, operated by KLM, was on a flight between Amsterdam and New York with 46 passengers and a crew of 10 on board. On the 5th of September 1954, the aircraft made a planned refueling stop at Shannon, Ireland, on flight number 633. Takeoff from there was at 2:30. Some 35 to 40 seconds after takeoff, the Triton crashed on the mudflats in the Shannon River about 2,500 meters from the end of the runway. Nobody at Shannon Airport had an idea that the crash had occurred when navigator TMN staggered into the terminal building covered with mud. After having crossed water and mudflats, it was only then that the rescue operations started. The aircraft was partly submerged, with the cabin filled with fuel fumes, which caused those passengers still in it to become unconscious and drown in the incoming tide. As usual, some passenger tried to light a cigarette, which a fellow passenger, Miss Elizabeth Snyder, knocked out of his mouth, or we would have been blown to bits, as Virgil commented. 25 passengers and 3 crew members were killed. The captain, who was only 1 year from being pensioned, was devastated by the accident and very bitter about his subsequent treatment by KLM. But one can only conclude from what it is known now that this captain, one of KLM's most experienced flyers, had sadly been remiss in the handling of the aircraft under his command. Aided and abetted by the lackadaisical TAR personnel, this resulted in the loss of not only a brand new aircraft with less than 2,500 hours of operation, but also that of 28 human lives. On the morning of 26th February 1960, Alitalia Flight 618 arrived at its first stopover at Shannon Airport for refueling in order to continue its journey across the Atlantic, while under the supervision of a Czech pilot. The flight had been given permission to take off from runway 05 with a clear but still dark and partially overcast sky just 45 minutes after its initial arrival. Takeoff proceeded without issue and the crew retracted the landing gear before making a left turn when the aircraft had climbed to a height of 165 feet with the landing lights still on. While turning, the aircraft's power was reduced slightly, but the flaps were never fully retracted. Instead of climbing, the airliner only accelerated and lost altitude very quickly. The pilots were unable to prevent the left wingtip from striking a stone wall near the Clonlohan Church, followed by the left engines and the rest of the wing, which also struck several gravestones of the surrounding cemetery. At this point, the aircraft's fate was sealed, and after the propellers of the right engine also scraped past the wall, the out-of-controlled aircraft slammed into the ground and in an open field beyond the cemetery and burst into flames. The post-crash fire quickly engulfed the aircraft and badly burned most of the survivors as locals and rescue workers arrived at the scene. The fire gutted the wreckage, leaving the tail section as the only recognizable part left of the aircraft. The crash also took its toll on passengers and crew on board, with only a single crew member surviving the crash, alongside 17 passengers who were all very seriously injured. Vincent McInerney of Stonehall is a member of the Clonlohan Cemetery Group, but he was just a schoolboy at the time of the crash, which he remembers well. The plane must have come in very low because it hit the top of the headstone and it went through the graveyard and crashed into the next field. There was a lot of wreckage and it was burned up, he recalled. The huge plane, which was carrying some 7,000 gallons of fuel at the time, struck the ground at about 20 yards from the corner of the Clonlohan Cemetery. It ploughed through a stout high wall, knocked over a number of headstones and then burned a path through the pasture before breaking through a sod fence. It came to rest at the bottom of a hill in soft, marshy land. Scattered bits of fuselage, as well as cargo and the personal belongings of the passengers, were strewn over both fields, covering almost 3/4 of a mile. At the end of the burned corridor lay the gutted fuselage. Only the tail section remained reasonably intact. The Shannon priest, the Reverend Thomas Comerford, was one of the first to reach the scene. "I heard crying and screaming as if people were being burned to death," he said. "It was horrible." One old man said he was a monk, staggered out badly burned. He said most of the people on board were Catholics and he asked that they should be given the last rites. I took the man's passport, the priest said, and found that his name is Giuseppe Caracoli, with a forwarding address at Gunhill, the Bronx 67. There were bodies scattered all over the field, the priest went on. People were mixed up with the remains of sheep the plane had killed. Most of the bodies were horribly mutilated. People were screaming, sheep were crying, and dogs were barking. It was like a scene from hell. The 1961 President Airlines Douglas DC-6 crash occurred on the night of September the 10th, 1961, when a President Airlines Douglas DC-6B named Theodore Roosevelt, outbound from Shannon, crashed into the nearby River Shannon shortly after takeoff, killing all 83 people on board. To date, this crash remains the deadliest one on Irish territory. The aircraft involved was a Douglas DC-6B registered November 90773. It first flew in 1953 and was powered by four Pratt & Whitney R2800 engines. The aircraft's occupants and the accident flight consisted of 77 passengers and 6 crew members. The aircraft was on an unscheduled international passenger flight from Dusseldorf in Germany to Chicago with stopovers in Shannon and Gander, Newfoundland for refueling. Shortly after takeoff from Shannon Airport's runway 24, the pilots were cleared for a right-hand turn, but they instead turned left and kept turning until the aircraft had reached a bank angle of about 90 degrees or more. Unable to recover, the aircraft plummeted into the River Shannon from 5,000 feet from the end of the runway. There were no survivors among the 83 passengers. Subsequent investigations indicate that the crash probably resulted from a malfunctioning attitude indicator, a fault in the starboard ailerons, or both. Poor weather conditions and crew fatigue were also cited as contributing factors.